Morning, welcome to Kathy's Cute Creations. Today is week five, the assembly, the last week of Fir The Most part. So here is the paper you should have downloaded. It will look like that when you're finished. So the only thing you should have are strips, and you should have one little set of squares like that. And we're gonna go ahead and we're gonna put this together. All right, let's get started. I'm excited to see how it's gonna turn out.
So this is for my binding, so we can set that aside, whatever you've chosen for your binding. And we're going to take our squares and our cream white, whatever color you're using for your strips. We're going to sew them together first because they go right here. Whoops. Let me get the in the camera here. So they're going to go right here along the bottom after we connect our trees and our stars. So we're going to do that first. You're connecting the, I'm going to call these the tall trees. They actually have four pieces to them. We're going to put them all together with a strip in between. So let me read the directions. First off, as you can see right here, we're just going to connect them. So we're taking our 16 white cream, whatever color this is, and our little, I believe these are G's. So all of this, whatever color you've chosen for G, if you've got your own fabrics, and we're going to make four sashing rows as seen in this figure. This is how I've set mine out because if you're no, not my case because I'm not watching TV or anything. I don't have any distractions. But let's say that you've got somebody in the house with you and you've got a whole bunch of noise in the background and you're trying to concentrate. So the best thing to do is take out four strips. I believe I've got four here. Yeah. So you're going to take four sets of four. So I've already laid them out. One, two, three, four. And then you'll have three of the little squares. And I put them all together. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do this one, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to change this. So I pin this one. I'll pin one to there, there, and there. And then we'll go like that so that when I'm done, I'll have them all finished. But this way, if there's something going on in the background, I won't forget where I'm at because I don't have any of the other fabrics sitting down here. So nothing can get mixed up and I end up making too many. Or if I keep going in a row and connect them all, that'll mess me up. So it's easier for me to just do it this way. So that's the way I'm going to do it.
If you're watching the story, Josephine and Sawyer, I think they got a little bit of chemistry between them. But what I'm gonna say is I'm gonna go back a couple of days and her mother called her up. And her mother also, for those that don't know the story, her mother is a writer, a very famous writer, by the way. And she's very upset with Josephine's last boyfriend who is trying to, well, I don't even know what the heck you call it. I don't know what the, I don't think it's slander. He's trying to take the credit for all the books that, her last book that she wrote. And he's such a bad guy. Just to give a little bit of background, she thought he was the love of her life. She fell for him hard. He took her, for everything she was worth, he literally robbed her of her bank account. And it's taken a lot for her to get over that. So she went away. This is why she's where she's at. And she is, I'm going to call it house sitting. And right now what's happening, the most recent thing is her mother called her the other day. And she never felt like her mother really liked her. I guess that's the correct word. I mean, I don't know. The relationship with mom or something else, I'm telling you. Now, I had a okay relationship with my mother, but then on the other hand, my sister didn't. So I think that my mother chose favorites, which I find horrible. But, you know, it happens. I can't just turn a blind eye to it. It did happen. But anyway, back to the story. So her mother gives her a call, and her mother says, oh, my gosh, this guy is out of control. And what is she doing about it? Has she got a lawyer? And she goes, no, I don't have a lawyer. She kind of wants it to go away, but I'm telling you what, this guy is tenacious. He's not letting go of anything. He's going to end up with the money from her book sales if she's not careful. But anyway, so her mother said, you know what, then I'm going to get my lawyer involved. Well, in the meantime, somebody suggested that they put a spell on him. This is one of her girlfriends that she talks to frequently. So she went, got a list, because, you know, this is This town is all about witchcraft. Everybody knows what's going on, but when you're new in town, you don't get to know anything. But anyway, so they went ahead and they've told her, somebody gave her a list of what to get, and then every time she went to approach somebody to get it, I mean, like one lady, I think, had three of the things that were on the list, they gave her eyes like, what are you gonna do with that? Well, the very last thing she got was some type of stone, and the woman was like leery to give it to her, and she goes, do you know what this stone does? And she said she wasn't sure. Let me go ahead and I'm going to stop right here before I start getting myself messed up. And so the lady continued to tell her that this stone would show the truth and that it needed to be given to somebody that was pure, and she needed to make sure that this individual was pure. Well, actually, she's getting it for herself, so we already know that she's pure of heart. And she's not really giving it away to a friend. She just said that. She doesn't really want anybody to know what's going on, but I'm going to tell you what, those small towns, they find out everything. And it's a good thing, in a way, that they actually like her, because, you know, if they didn't even like her, they would have never, first off, even suggested that they, that there is a such thing as a curse, because they're constantly denying there's anything about witchcraft. Not that they're denying they have Wiccan in that town, I think that's how you pronounce it, but that witchcraft isn't real and all that. But anyway, so today's episode, now it is Saturday, and it's the day before our, I mean the day before, it's the weekend of our assembly for coming up Monday in a couple days. And she came out this morning and saw Sawyer, which is the gentleman who's been working in the graveyard fixing all the stones. And a lot of the stones have been damaged, and he was very upset by them. Well, he asked her to go get him a bucket of water. So when she went to get him a bucket, she turned around to say something to him, and he was working on a headstone, and he put his finger... Well, she stopped and watched him because it looked like he was doing something. I mean, he had his back to her, so she wasn't sure what he was doing. But it just kind of made her leery a little bit and scared. And he did something with his hands, and the next thing you know, she, even from the distance she was at, because, you know, this graveyard is not that far from the house, so it's not like you need binoculars to see from one end to the other or anything. But she realized that the crack he had been working on, that when he ran his finger across it, it became totally fixed as if it never had a crack. And she gasped, and that's when he turned around real quick. Of course, you know, she said that it looked like magic, and he said, no, it was the adhesive that he had put. He said, they make it perfect. She went over there and looked at it, and she said it looked like it had never been broken. So she didn't believe that for a minute. And then, he got his composure back and said, I really need that bucket of water. So she went ahead and went back into the house. So now I'm beginning to think maybe he's got a little bit of witchiness. Is that such a word? In him. So I can't. To me, it's getting more interesting and more interesting. I'd like to know if, but also I'd like to know what's going on with that so-called boyfriend, ex-boyfriend, I should say. If that spell is going to work on him, or if the lawyer's going to work. I think the lawyer's going to work first. But her mother said to just prove that she'd written the books, and she goes, I can't because my laptop was destroyed and I didn't back anything up. Of course, her mother raised Cain with her saying, what do you mean you never backed it up? She had to back that up. And she goes, well, I didn't, and now I can't because, you know, the laptop fried on her and the goat ate the manuscript that she had written. But this is her previous work. She still didn't ever back that up. Which is just, I don't know. I can't even believe she didn't to do that. But then, you know, they got those. And, of course, I don't know what kind of laptop she had. But, I mean, she could have had Apple. And I don't know anything about an Apple. But these laptops, when you first got your laptop, the Windows, when you were writing up whatever you were writing up, it automatically saved. Every so many minutes, it just saved your copy, whether you wanted to or not. Now, I realize her laptop got fried and all that, but even though that happened, I still would have taken it in to someone who knows about computers to see if anything could have been saved. Because we don't really know what kind of emergency, I mean, what kind of, like, electricity when it went out. It didn't say it, like, blew it up and caught it on fire. It just went out, so... Maybe part of her manuscripts would have been saved. I don't know what she did with her first one, though. I don't know if she pitched it or if she still has it, which has all that information on. Her second laptop has her manuscript she's working on now. I just know she's got to get this settled or this guy's going to steal this manuscript she's working on. Okay, you guys go ahead and finish up your strips, and then we'll be back here to start connecting our squares.
Now, the picture is showing that this strip is on the right-hand side.
Let me show the picture here. Right here. So it's the right-hand hand of 1, 2, 3. And no, it's not on the right-hand side of this one. It's 3 strips. Make sure you only do 3. And then this is what I did. So I laid my strip on this right-hand side, right here. I turned it. So now the bottom is to the left, and this is the top. And then I pinned it so that when I flipped it back, the tree is right side up. If you accidentally do it on that side, it's not right side up. It's nothing to the world, because remember, looking at the pattern, you can get away with it right here. Okay. And then after I get these 3 done, then I'll turn around and put the other ones on. So I'll attach the other side. Nope, let me get my pin cushion. Hold on one sec. There we go. And every place that my fabric was ironed and folded over, that's where I'm putting my pins. If you're wondering where I'm putting them, you can put your clips there too, but it's to hold it down. The advantage of the pin over the clip is that you can get right up to the pin with your needle and it won't have flipped on you. Now, I've noticed that the little normal size of these little clips that everybody uses, now that my hands aren't working like they were when I was younger, those little clips are too hard for me. So I went ahead and I've tried to purchase the medium, but do you know how hard it is to find that on Amazon? And none of my stores that I go to, my little independent, have the medium. They all have those little bitty ones. And that's fine when you first start out, but when your hands don't do it anymore, it's not fine anymore. Now, I got like 4 of those medium one time in a box or a package or something. And up to that point, I didn't even know they had medium. But I think of those medium, I've turned around and used them in other places in my house, not just in my sewing room. So of course, I don't have any mediums up here. So the ones that I got that looked like the medium, believe it or not, online, were called jumbo. So I went ahead and I bought me one, I think it was 50 of them come in a little, like a little plastic case or whatever, just to see if that actually is what it is. And I'm trying to get my fabric to line up the top of it. That's what I'm doing here. And then if it does work, let's go a little closer to catch that fabric. Okay, so if that does work, then I will switch out my smaller ones. I've got to start making up a box to give away for all, because I've got so many YouTubers and I still haven't even done that. My daughter's coming over tomorrow. Maybe she'll help me pick some things out and put it in the box. And I know I have a case of those. I think I got them on a little bitty basket of some of those for those that can still use them. I mean, my daughter and my granddaughter can use them. It's just that I can't. They're just getting too difficult. I actually broke one the other day, too, when I was using it. When I was doing that binding on that little mini quilt. I don't know how it happened, but it broke. Of course, you know, sometimes they have flaws and eventually things break. Even some of us break down every now and then, I hate to say it. But it happens. Make sure you, I'm glad I looked. I did not put my right sides together on this, so I've got to stop and repin it.
That's not what happened at all.
It was this piece. That's the piece that was on the wrong side. This one was correct. But this one was turned around the other direction. So now I'm going to sew this back together before I sew the strip on. I'm sure glad I stopped and showed you guys how I was doing this. First, I thought I wasn't going to show you, but I thought, nah, I think I need to show you. All right, let me get that taken care of. I laid it side by side
Then I folded this one over and I pinned this on this side. So I'm going to go ahead and sew it. Then when I get done sewing it, I'll have one with no strip, one with a strip on that side, and one with a strip on this side to put the next one, which has the strip already sewn right here. This one's got the strip sewn. And I'll put that on next. So now that I'm thinking about it, and I made a comment about the box that I need to be creating to give away, what are some of the things that you guys would want to see in a box? I mean, do you want a new rotary cutter? Do you want the blades? A pair of scissors? I mean, I don't really know. Do people want that kind of thing? Do you just want fabric in it? How about panels? I got a panel coming for my great-grandbaby that I got to make. Got to get that done before next month the baby's due. As soon as I get it, I'll show it to you. It's I'm trying to think, where did I buy it? I think I got it from Missouri Star Quilt Company, I do believe. And it's their giraffe one. I don't know how much abuse or whatever this blanket's going to take, so I'm trying to get something that I know is going to be sturdy and work. I did have another idea for a blanket. This camera up a little bit. I didn't want it to be smacking all this fabric that's hanging off this table. Anyway, so I watched the Quilt Roadies. She's another YouTuber. And she got a pattern that's just two rectangles. No, excuse me, one rectangle. But it's the way that you put it that creates the block. So she researched it because she couldn't find the pattern. And she researched it because she wanted to make sure that she could talk about it if somebody couldn't buy the pattern anymore. So she found the store, talked to the person at the store, and they said that it's no longer out there, but that she can feel free to give out the directions, that was fine. And then if you know, you can check it out on her video. She talks all about it. Tells the different sizes. She's written it all up on a piece of paper. I didn't. I just, while I listened to her video, I just jotted down the size that the rectangle needed to be, and then I just drew a picture. And I'm going to tell you right now, I am no artist about how to put it together so that I could figure out how to do it. But I was just going to do that for the baby blanket and just do it all in pastels because it'll work. I believe she said it took, if I'm not mistaken now, it took 7 different fabrics to make this. Alrighty, so this is, whoops, I tucked that underneath there and I shouldn't have. This is our last block on this corner, or on this strip, shouldn't say this corner. This is the corner block on that strip. Once it starts getting longer, it starts getting heavy, pulling off the table and all kinds of stuff. Anyway, so the size of these, this rectangle, so what you do is you build, excuse me, a square. So the first thing you do is you're making strips, and they are, each little rectangle is 2.5 by 4.5. So you sew 2 of them. Now these are different colors. You don't sew them the same color. And then you sew you a pile of them. Then you take, and now those are long end to long end. Then you're going to do a pile of short end to short end, and I will show you, I'm trying to think, I'll show you on a piece of fabric here. And then once you got them stacked up, you go back and forth, back and forth. And I'm thinking about making a square. I've got some fabric that I bought that I really like. I ironed it and I bleed it out here on my ironing board. It's kind of scrunched because my ironing board isn't long enough. It flows right off the ironing board. Alrighty, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to take these strips now right here on my chair that I made, and I'm going to iron them and attach it to this. Now this roll is that roll that has those little red cornerstones on it, which I think really pop this. They really stick out and make it look good. And after we get done putting this on, then it's going to be nothing but a repeat of all of this. You're going to make your 4 blocks in the row. You're going to put the little side sashing, the white or the light, whatever you're using for yours. And then we're going to take the strips that we made at the very beginning of this video, and we're going to add them, and they match up with the
bottom of the little tree. I was going to say a stem. The base of the tree. And so my trees, I ironed the fabric in towards the brown fabric. And then for the red ones, this is why I was waiting until the last minute, I ironed it the other direction so that I could nestle these two when it comes time to put them together. That's why I was waiting. And then as I was ironing this, the trees, after I finished putting the sashing between each tree that I had to, I went ahead and I re-ironed. This way, it's just extra reinforcement of the way that the actual block has to lay. Because sometimes it just doesn't want to go the direction you want it to go, and so you're going to more or less make it with your iron. Oops. Uh-oh. All right, I got to stop and find that before my dog does.
Couldn't find it.
Oh, my gosh. I'll probably step on the head. Thank goodness it's not very big. Or he's going to find it, and I hope he doesn't. At least he didn't get up over here and try to find out what I was looking for, which is what my little Lainey would have done. A little nosiness. She'd be over here on top of me trying to check it out, and I'd have to be telling her to move or picking her up. He just laid there and looked at me like, what are you looking for? Did you drop something? Like not a care in the world. That's funny. They are so different. And the older he gets, the more relaxed he gets too. He's got, it's like he's taking a chill pill constantly. All right, so I decided not to show you how to make those squares until I cut those squares out, and then I'll just cut them out and show you a video. Give you all the dimensions and show you what it's supposed to look like, and I can tell you everything about it because it's talks about how many you need for a baby blanket versus a crib versus a twin, that kind of thing. Of course, that wouldn't be hard for you to figure out anyway, so. I always get to the end and I feel like I don't have enough fabric, so there we go. I almost didn't knock my thing down there. All right, so let's go ahead and iron this and we're going to take a look at it. Look how that red pops. I can't even do it justice with the lighting in here. I got every light on in this room. You can see that deep, deep red. I moved my iron off my iron board so I could set this up a little bit better. Sometimes I feel like this room is closing in on me. Alrighty, we're going to go ahead and we're going to do, I'm just going to automatically do the next set of trees since I've got them down and just do one row after the other. Then I'll probably do, what's the next one say? The next one says the other trees. So I'll just do all the trees and then I'll just turn around and do the stars and then I'll put them together. But all I'm going to do is put the blocks together for starters and then I'll put the strips. So you guys go ahead and do all that on your own too, and then we'll meet back here when you're finished, before we start building it. I mean, before we start putting our outer strips on. Okay, so I'm looking at this paper, and here's what I have done. So I have connected the first thing I did was I sewed this row in the middle to that row. Then I went and sewed this row to this row. So this one is sitting aside over here to the other side of my sewing machine. Here is the first row. Let me lift this up a little bit here so you can see it. I don't have anywhere to lay this out. Oh, goodness, here we go. Okay, so here's the first two rows. And we're gonna slowly go over here. I don't wanna make anybody dizzy. And here is the house and the star again, okay? And the only thing separating them, I'm going to flip the paper over here, is this row with, no, there's nothing separating them. The only thing separating these right now is me sewing this row right here. Once I sew it, I can either do that, which gives me four rows completed,
then add this one, or go ahead and sew this one to this one, and then add it. Now, so far I've ironed, every time I've done something, I've ironed it just to make sure that it's like doubly pressed and everything. But I wanna go ahead and do these two so I can just add the one, because I like to do things in pairs. So I'm gonna take these two, which are already done here, and I'm gonna add them to these two, and then I will add this row, and then we're gonna do the sashing. Now, all the time on these specific Fort Worth Fabric Studio directions, we take the sets of strips. So as you notice here, it is the green strip before the red strip, and they always want you to put them, and you can tell by this here, they want you to put them on the top, and I mean, excuse me, the sides first on the left and the right, and then you put the top over and the bottom. And it's the same thing when you come and you do the red. And it says right here, you're adding the inner border to the sides and then the top and the bottom. And the sides are the smaller distance, so your little strips should fit. If they don't fit, you're not gonna have a whole bunch of them connected together. So always the sides and then the top. So let's go ahead and we're gonna put this row to this row. Okay, here we go. There's the finished quilt. So I hope you guys like this video. Give me a thumbs up. Remember, you're gonna make a comment and tell me what you want me to put in the box for the giveaway, because I've got so many subscribers now. So thank you everybody for watching. Subscribe if you haven't yet, and I will see you next time. Bye-bye, everyone.
Well, thank you.
Thanks, Sherry, for holding up the quilt.